Hello everyone. I am here with a Bible study. I hope you guys are having a great night. Tonight's Bible study is going to be in the book of John. We are going to read John chapter 1. I'm going to read all of John chapter 1. Which, let's see here. It's really not that long. It's a little longer than some of the others, but not longer than some we've read. That's not saying much, is it? But I love the Bible studies. Do you guys like the Bible studies? I love them. I want to read to you right now. It's so beautiful. I want to read to you. It's in the New International Version. I'll be reading in the New International Version as well. John chapter 1, verse 38 and 39. Turning around, Jesus saw them following and asked, "What do you want?" They said, "Rabbi," which means teacher. "Where are you staying?" "Come," he replied, "and you will see." So they went and saw where he was staying, and they spent the day with him. It was about 4 in the afternoon. So the time, remember this when it says that, because this says it's in the NIV, the New International Version, and I am reading in the New International Version Bible. Now remember what this says here, 4 in the afternoon. Because when I read it in the Bible, it says something different in the book. Can't remember exactly what it says offhand. I think it says the 10th hour, but I'm not exactly for sure. But I'll read a devotion after we read from the Bible. So let's go ahead, and I'm going to read John chapter 1 for us. Love you. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it. There came a man who was sent from God. His name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning the light, so that through him all men might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light, the true light that gives light to every man that was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. John testifies concerning him. He cries out, saying, "This was he of whom I said, 'He who comes after me has surpassed me, because he was before me.' From the fullness of his grace, we have all received one blessing after another. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but God, the one and only, who was at the Father's side, has made him known. Now this was John's testimony when the Jews of Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to ask him who he was. He did not fail to confess, but confessed freely, "I am not the Christ." They asked him, "Then who are you? Are you Elijah?" I don't know why they think everybody that comes there is Elijah. They thought John the Baptist was Elijah. They thought Jesus was Elijah. Why is everybody Elijah to them? I do not know why. He said, "I am not. Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Finally, they said, "Who are you? Give us an answer to take it back to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" John replied in the words of Isaiah the prophet, "I am the voice of one calling in the wilderness. Make straight the path for the Lord." Now some Pharisees who had been sent questioned him, "Why then do you baptize if you are not the Christ, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" "I baptize with water," John replied, "but among you stands one you do not know. He is the one who comes after me, the thongs of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie." This all happened at Bethany, on the other side of the Jordan, where John was baptizing. Little fact for you guys. John the Baptist and Jesus are first cousins. Elizabeth is Mary's older sister, and Elizabeth was probably 6 months pregnant with John the Baptist when Mary became pregnant with Jesus. So that's how much older John is than Jesus. So John was born before Jesus, and that's why he became, you know, "I'm going to go before you and make the path straight and, you know, make a way for you." John was before Jesus, but Jesus was before John because Jesus was already in heaven and was sent down. So he was already before John, but he comes after John as in human form. Okay. But they never got a chance to like meet each other, because back then families lived far apart and they didn't see each other hardly ever, because they didn't travel much and stuff. They had to take care of their own families and things. They didn't have much money in different parts of the places and stuff, so they didn't get to see each other like I don't get to see mine either, but I mean, back then, some families didn't see their families for years, if at all, ever again. But John the Baptist and Jesus were first cousins. And John the Baptist baptized Jesus in the Jordan River. And John didn't want to baptize Jesus. And Jesus told him it had to be done. And because Jesus wanted to be baptized. And when Jesus came up out of the water from being baptized, the heavens opened up, the sky opened up, and a voice came from heaven. A dove came down and landed on Jesus's shoulder, and there was people there, you know, people all standing around like there always is, watching the baptisms and getting back, waiting to get baptized, just like there is today. And the dove landed on Jesus's shoulder, and a voice from heaven, which was God, said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." So you know those people believed when that happened. Okay, so I just wanted to let you guys know that part. so. The next day, John saw Jesus coming towards him and said, "Look, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. This is the one I meant when I said, 'A man who comes after me has surpassed me, because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but the reason I came baptizing with water was that he might be revealed to Israel." Then John gave this testimony: "I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. I would not have known him except that the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, 'The man on whom you see the Spirit come down and remain is he who will baptize with the Holy Spirit.' I have seen and I testify that this is the Son of God." See, John just baptized with water to cleanse their body. Jesus is baptizing with the Holy Spirit. He's baptizing with God. He puts the fire in you. He puts the Holy Spirit in you. Nobody else could do that. Jesus did. And the authority that Jesus could give to the people to do that to. And it was passed on to people that can, which can do that today. Okay. The next day, John was there again with two of his disciples. When he saw Jesus passing by, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." When the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. Turning around, Jesus saw them following and asked, "What do you want?" They said, "Rabbi," which means teacher. Now it's coming up on the part I was talking about the time. Okay, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" "Come," he replied, and you will see." So they went, and they saw where he was staying, and spent that day with him. It was about the 10th hour. So here it says the 10th hour, but in there it says it was about 4 in the afternoon. And this says it was about the 10th hour. And these are both the New International Version, so I don't know what their timing is there. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus. The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, "We have found the Messiah," that is, the Christ. And he brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You will be called Cephas," which when translated is Peter. The next day, Jesus decided to leave for Galilee. Finding Philip, he said to him, "Follow me." Philip, like Andrew and Peter, was from the town of Bethsaida. Philip found Nathanael and told him, "We have found the one Moses wrote about in the law, and about whom the prophets also wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." From there, the son of Joseph of Nazareth. "Can anything good come from there?" Nathanael asked. "Come and see," said Philip. When Jesus saw Nathanael approaching, he said of him, "Here is a true Israelite in whom there is nothing false." "How do you know me?" Nathanael asked. Jesus answered, "I saw you while you were still under the fig tree, before Philip called you." Then Nathanael declared, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus said, "You believe because I told you I saw you under the fig tree. You shall see greater things than that." He then added, "I tell you the truth. You shall see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man. And that was all of John chapter 1. I wished I could go on reading and reading and reading it to you guys. I would love to. Let's go ahead and go on reading chapter 2 and 3. I'd love to. All right, so let's go ahead and read the devotion that goes with John chapter 1. Let's see who wrote this one tonight. Sharon Hennick wrote tonight's devotion. Let's see what it says. As I read the first chapter of John today, I was challenged by Jesus' words to the disciples who approached him. I spend a lot of time asking Jesus to come into my life, my day, my activities. I tell him about my goals and ask him to bless them. In effect, I'm saying, come see what I'm up to and join me. But I often have things backward. These disciples asked Jesus where he was staying. Although they were speaking of a physical location, their question reminded me to ask this of Jesus in a metaphorical way. I can ask him what he is focusing on that day, where he is staying. Is there a ministry at my church that is being prompted forward in a new way where I could contribute? Is there a theme regarding character or Christian discipleship among my circle of friends that he is stirring up to encourage us to grow a new direction? Instead of setting my own course, I can acknowledge Jesus as my teacher and follow him. Yes, 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 amen. Loving the way she's thinking right now. Loving this very, very much. And I'm sure Jesus is too. Let's take our cue from the disciples who first met Jesus by the shores of the Jordan River. We can ask him to open our eyes so we can see where he is staying. We can drop our own agendas and stick close to him as those early followers did. We can spend the day with Jesus. Our day will glow with a new richness as we watch him at work in our world. Amen. Can you imagine? There is no end to the possibilities of the things Jesus can do in your life. No end to the possibilities. And let's see what our homework is for tonight. Read a church newsletter, a daily paper, or a few emails from friends. Where do you see Jesus at work in these things? Ask him how you can join him in that work. Newspaper, email from a friend, they may be having a problem or something, or they may have joined a new activity. Ask Jesus, where can I fit in this situation? Maybe they just opened a new soup kitchen, or they just started working at one. Well, maybe I could ask them if they need help, or, you know, something like that. So that is our homework for tonight. All right, guys, I hope you guys enjoyed tonight's Bible study, and I hope you guys have a great rest of your night. Bye, guys.